to welcome Reinhard Blatt from the University of Innsbruck here. And he's going to give a lecture in our quantum information technologies course. So Reinhard Blatt leads the Institute for Experimental Physics there, as well as the Institute for Quantum Optics and Quantum Information of the Austrian Academy of Science, and he has been a world leader in research using ion traps for quantum interference, quantum metrology, quantum information tasks and processes. So thank you very much for taking the time and being to teach us.
Thank you. Thank you, Yasser. Welcome, everybody. And as already said, I'm trying to give these two lectures, and that's a very short amount of time, on the subject of the experimental implementation of quantum information processing with these trapped ions. That's the work, as indicated, that was done in Innsbruck over the last years. And these talks are divided in, say, two main subjects. The first subject is really about the concepts that we have here, about some details on quantum gate operations and how we generate entanglement of trapped ions with these gate operations. I deliberately just chose to put in a few more transparencies about details this morning, just to make sure that some of the concepts are better understood to you, because I realized from the discussions that some of the underlying bases are not so much known. I will also go to the advanced procedures later on, and this is about scaling the ion quantum computer and some stuff that we did with these things recently. I really don't care how far we get here. You will see how this goes. I just went through two or three slides on the subject during the colloquium, but let's just concentrate on the basic subjects first, because I think that's important. And this is the first title, and here is something I've given to Yasser. These are, of course, four review articles that are all available to you as PDF files. So you can study them after the talk, and also you will get also the handouts of the lectures that will be available as PDF files after the talk, because it could very well be that I just talk about different things while I'm talking here, because I have many slides, and then I will just provide the handouts after the stuff that you know, what you've seen on the screen, if things go too fast. Also, feel free to slow me down. It is important that you understand these things right out from the beginning, because later on I rely on the fact that you have understood these things, and then we are using them over and over again. And I know perfectly well that we have been working on this for almost 20 years now, so some of these things are ingrained and sort of easy for me, but I know and certainly understand that from my students that they are certainly not easy for you. So let me tell you, please interrupt me and ask questions. So this is about the generics of quantum information processing, the ion trap quantum computer, the spectroscopy that we need to do that, some measurements, basic interactions and gate operations, and until we can really do entanglement operations. So I think these are the basics that need to be understood in the first lecture for the next 45 to 50 minutes. And as for lecture, I have given you all the chapter titles here, and you will see in each chapter what we do. So let's start out with the generics. And this is pretty much what you heard already in the colloquium. So this is, again, the same transparency that you've seen in the colloquium. Why do we do quantum information processing? I don't want to dwell on this because you remember that from the colloquium. The whole stuff started essentially with Peter Shor's invention of the Shor algorithm, in which he could show that with a quantum computer, you would be able to factor a number of L digits much faster than on a classical computer. This scales exponentially with the length of the digits on a classical computer, whereas it scales only polynomially on a quantum computer. And that is the big advantage that we have with quantum computers that started the hype and the search how to realize a quantum computer. The database problem is the other significant algorithm that we have at this time. There's a few more. I can come back to that if you ask questions what else is available. But this is the other one that is usually is a so-called inversion about the mean and finding, say, optimizing an optimum of a procedure or an optimum of a problem. And that is the so-called Grover algorithm by Lav Grover from Lucent. Simulation of Schrödinger equations, that is, I told you, already one of the hot topics right now. And if you have some sufficient time, I would like to show you two different subjects that I have not covered 2 days ago in the colloquium during this talk. And I will come back to more of the spectroscopy part, and this is something, this is the fundamental things that we maybe also cover error correction then in the final part of the talk. Again, remember, computation is always a physical process. So you have to set the initial conditions, you have to operate these things, and you have to read the final outcome of the computation. No matter where you do it, whether you do this in your head, on a piece of paper, or with the abacus here, or whatever you do, you have to realize these things with physical objects, physical processes. In classical computers, these are bits, registers, gates, classical processes, they're just switches, and they are usually of a dissipative nature. Whereas in a quantum computer, we have to see what the equivalent is. We need quantum bits, quantum registers, quantum gates. Usually, we have not switches, just projections in this case. We have coherent processes, and we need to prepare and manipulate entangled states to keep the and preserve the coherence in the system. These are, again, the DiVincenzo criteria. Remember, there are 7 criteria. It's about qubits. We need to scale things up with qubits. We need to be able to set arbitrary input states, need long coherence times, universal set of gates, and the measurement capability, depending on how you implement things. And then, of course, you will want to do networking as well. You see that transparency as well. Again, we just come up with the basis. The basis is the equivalent of a classical bit, which is a state in 0 or 1, and the bit rolls. So the basic element is the quantum bit. And this is nothing but our old-fashioned two-level systems with the probability amplitude C0 and C1. But the difference comes already in here. Since we have now that state of the computer, we have to formulate a direct product, which really means we need to write down the state, the quantum state, as a complete superposition of all of these things. And whatever you do here, of course, affects the entire state, and everything else feels it, because there is a superposition, that's the entangled state that we have here, whereas in the classical computer you don't feel that. And I've already mentioned this, the universal quantum gate operations. We need to be able to put this arrow at an arbitrary positions on this Bloch sphere for a two-level system, and we need to make arbitrary rotations about a certain angle, theta and phi. Just one question here. Is everybody familiar with the notion of a Bloch sphere? So everybody knows that, because that's the first thing I need to know, and I'll come back to that over and over again. I'll take it for granted and I'll talk about this. Okay, the second thing is that we need to make now these so-called C0 gate operations. C0 gate operations are, of course, the equivalent of the classical XOR. So whenever a controlling amplitude is set, we want the target amplitude to be flipped. But that has to hold in a superposition manner. And together, these are already a set of universal operations, and that's the most important point. And then we have a blueprint, as shown before. We have now this sequence of single and two qubit operations of the C0 type, and then we have to finally to measure things. Of course, this is completely reversible. There was also a question about that a few days ago. But then, finally, in order to get the result, you have the classical outcome, which is the projection right here. So the circuit quantum computer model now has a certain notation. This notation is such that you have a qubit, in this case it's epsilon 1, or E1, and this is the E2. So these are timelines. And this line stands for a two-level system, which progresses from left to right in time. And this is the shorthand notation for the so-called C0 gate operation. What does the C0 gate operation actually do? Now, the C0 gate operation simply says, okay, flip the target state if and only if the controlling qubit is set. So if that's a 1, then you just flip that one. But flipping that in a dual notation is tantamount to saying there's an addition modulo 2. Okay, so this is the notation that we do. This is the mathematical operation. And this is the shorthand notation. So whenever you see that sign, okay, this is the controlling part and this is the target part, and I have to make that unitary. So the diagram that I had before would be then written in such a way, so this is a single qubit operation. Okay, I have not noted yet the phi or the theta about which I do this and what kind of operation that is. but this is just a black box so far. But this is definitely a CNOT gate operation. And this is how we set up the circuits. So when you just go and set up and have an algorithm, I want to break down the algorithm in these gate operations, then I write down my circuit diagram, and then I have to go down and really implement it in my hardware. So these realization concepts here, you've seen that too, are manifold. There are many many quantum systems available with which you could do these things. So for example, the first things that have been investigated was nuclear magnetic resonance and complicated molecules. But the two-level systems are really used as the nuclear spins of the individual molecules. And you can address those by just addressing them in frequency space, because they are different in the magnetic field. And then you just really can say, okay, I want to keep that spin down while I flip the other up. Or if that's down, then I flip that. So you can make CNOT gate operations all the way. The difficulty is always that this holds only for an individual molecule, but the signals that you get are of course obtained from a mixture. And there's nothing like entanglement in such a system. So people have abandoned the idea. They could show the individual operations in the 90s, but in the late 90s, early 2000s, people realized there won't be a quantum speed up due to that fact, because it's always mixtures that you measure. There's no entanglement in the system. Therefore, they usually don't do this anymore, unless you can come up with a technique that makes the system so pure, so clean, that you can really make use of entangling operations in the system. But since this system consists of about 10 to the 18 particles, that's very, very hard to do, to really get a strong enhancement of that system. So far, nobody is doing this anymore. Seriously, there's a few experiments still on the way in solid states. And if you can single out single particles, and this is done by Michelle Simmons and their co-workers at the University of New South Wales, they are trying to embed single phosphorus ions in a silicon matrix and really get access to these individual atoms. This was one of the questions we had in the colloquium. This is what they can do, and they already can make these operations individual on these things, but this is pretty much the same as what we do with trapped ions, because these atoms are sitting side by side in the silicon matrix. Okay, and then there's quantum dots. So you have engineered quantum dots as electrodes, and in these pits here you can just localize single electrons. They behave as individual two-level systems, and they can be manipulated. This is one of our old-fashioned traps when we still had the shilling in Austria and not the euro, so this is a long time ago. This is superconductors, so it looks fuzzy, but it isn't, because that's a shadow matrix, and this is cavity QED techniques. We could go through all these things in detail and see what are the pros and cons, but again, I don't have the time for that. I'd rather want you to understand this for single technology, because most of these things can be translated. And this is the transparency you've seen before. You find more ideas here. Think of the quantum systems that need to be controlled and manipulated. I think that's the most important part here. And you really need access to the individual degrees of freedom. If you don't have access, there's no chance that you can really control the Hilbert space. That's the huge space where all these computational paths interfere. If you don't get that, then you can't control it, then you can't build a quantum computer. So you have to get access to all the degree of freedoms. Then, this is again the transparency for the DiLucenzo criteria in a different way. We need to find our individual two-level systems. As I said before, we need to be able to individually control them. And we need to make sure that they are stable and don't decay while I'm working on them, because they really need to be there. And when I just apply these pulses, they don't want to phase, you don't want them to decohere. And they need to interact in order to make a CNOT gate operation. There's no entanglement without any interaction. Think of this. Even if somebody tells you there's no interaction, and we will come later to the so-called entanglement swapping part, but that is sort of a teleportation protocol, and there is always an interaction necessary that you have to mimic, that you have to really make, otherwise these things don't work. I won't have the time to go into the teleportation stuff unless you tell me to do so. For this reason, I've assigned the task that Yasser has, and I would like you to really fulfill that, to carry out this simple computations. Is about one page of a computation that you should do to clarify what actually happens during the teleportation process. The teleportation process is, in our way of considering it, nothing but the simple algorithm how to convey information from one point A to point B. Okay, you need to be able to efficiently measure these systems, so projecting, so you see again the blogosphere up and down, and you have to be able to do this with nearly 100%. If you have less efficiency, then you lose in the system. Then of course, in the end, you want to do networking, and these are the two things that we have to find, so we need to make sure that we really can get interconnection between remote qubits. So let's go to the basis of the quantum computer for the ion trap. This is a very busy slide, and we don't want, I don't want to go through these things. Let me just walk you through a few things here. You can read it carefully after this is finished. These are the seven criteria: it's scalability, it's initialization, long coherence times, universal quantum gates, qubit measurements, and this network. And the question really is, how can we do this now with ions in a trap? This is also valid for an atomic physics implementation, but especially ions. So the internal atomic transition, of course, is usually a two-level system that we have, and this has to be formed. There's nothing like a two-level system, the real atom. You'll see how we do this later on, how you make a two-level system or make an atom behave like a two-level system. Then you have to apply laser cooling techniques. So the laser cooling part, I'll talk about that one too, is important to prepare things. State preparation is usually done by optical pumping. Then you use usually narrow transitions, either optical or microwave, with very long coherence time. So you have to be used to dealing with transitions that are not usually used in optical physics and atomic physics, because these are so-called forbidden transitions. These are clock transitions. And these are transitions, I'll show you how to realize that in atoms as well. Then you have to make the single qubit operations with very high fidelity. This is the notion of Rabi oscillations. Does everybody know the notion of a Rabi oscillation here? Please, hands up. Is anybody here who doesn't know what a Rabi oscillation is? Please, seriously, because then I'll explain it. Who does not know what a Rabi oscillation is? Okay. So if a Rabi oscillation, let me just try to explain it. Rabi oscillation. This is named after Isaac Rabi. Isaac Rabi was the guy who did spectroscopy, atomic spectroscopy, two-level system. There's our two-level system, there's the ground state and that's the excited state. So I apply the radiation, resonantly for example, and that radiation, of course, is tuned exactly resonantly to this transition. Then the interaction in a dipole approximation is the interaction Hamiltonian. Is usually given as the dipole moment mu times the electric field. Okay? This is the interaction energy in the system. When you just write this down in terms of frequencies, then you say, okay, the frequency is always h divided by h bar, and this is now, let's say, mu times e. We just take the absolute value for that, divided by h bar, and see this is the frequency. And this is the frequency that corresponds to that interaction strength. In other words, the real meaning is, if I take my blogosphere right now, and I have my Bloch vector which points up, and I apply this interaction resonantly, then what it does usually, I just go to a rotating frame, because the rotation is actually with a frequency difference. So what you usually do is you just go to a rotating frame. So this block vector is stuck still right here. But then you apply the radiation, bless you. And then when you apply the radiation that is resonant with that field E at this point, then this block vector tilts down there. If you apply the radiation resonantly for a longer time, it tilts up again and it goes on. So in other words, if I just would draw the population, that's the density matrix element of the excited state as a function of time, I would see this is 0 or is 1 at this point. It starts out in the ground state, then it goes up sinusoidally, goes up, goes down. This is what we call the Rabi oscillation. And this frequency is omega, this flopping frequency. Understood? So this Rabi frequency is very important because we always will talk about Rabi oscillations, and we will not only talk about Rabi oscillations but partial Rabi oscillations. And you can see, this is when I rotate the system about 2 pi, this is when I rotate the system about pi, this would be pi over 2, and so forth. When we talk about a pi over 2 pulse, this really means we apply the radiation only for this amount of time until the system ends here. When we talk about a pi pulse, the system ends there, and a 2 pi pulse would be pulse of that length. This is understood? That's what we call Rabi oscillation. You're in good company. I remember one of the international conferences on atomic physics, which are the most famous conferences in atomic physics, in 1984 in Seattle. And there was a guy named Isaac Rabi, the inventor of this, there in the audience, Nobel laureate. And there was Norman Ramsay in the audience, of course. And then these people met. I wasn't right there when this happened. Then a good friend of mine, Bill Phillips, who was also a Nobel laureate for laser cooling, he told me the story personally afterwards. They met, and somebody was mentioning the word Rabi frequency. "What's that?" Rabi said. What's that? And yeah, have you ever met? Doesn't live anymore. Norman Ramsay. Norman Ramsay, strong man, roaring laughter, loud voice. He was a booming voice and laughed like everything. Everybody was embarrassed that he laughed at his former boss, his PhD supervisor. Isaac Rabi did not know what the Rabi frequency was. And so they asked him, "Come on, why could you do that? Why did you laugh?" And he said, "I wrote a book about molecular beams and I used that expression all my time. But I didn't know what the Rabi frequency was." So you're in good company. Okay, so this is what we are going to do, Rabi oscillations. And the two qubit operations of the solar synoptype. I will lay out this a bit more in detail today because there was also some discussion we had yesterday. Apparently this was too fast. And I will go also into the spectroscopy part, so we need so-called quantum jump detection, which is sort of observing individual ion fluorescence. I don't have the time to go into this. If there is time in the end, we might come back. Again, you've seen that proposal. I can just skip this over. It's again the truth table that we need to fulfill. Think of this. This is the mathematical notation. I don't make use of it, but just keep that in mind, and this is what we want to realize. And again, these are the two-level systems. All of what I'm talking about today is again on the optical qubit in calcium 40. There are many other systems under investigation worldwide. Worldwide there are now about 50, 60 groups working on these single ions to realize quantum computation or quantum information processing. And very many of them are using low-lying states because they have no spontaneous decay. That system in calcium, for example, lives 1 second. If you go to the barium, it would live 40 seconds. And if you go to the ytterbium, there's a state available, which is an F state, that lives 6 years, which is amazing for an atom of an excitation right here. So, but you choose your poison and you have to live with it. Many other people simply think that the manipulation with Raman transition is better. Okay, that has some advantages, it has some disadvantages, but very many people use that. But you can easily translate these things immediately once you've understood how these things work. And this is again the same things that I showed you before. We want to line up these ions, and then we want to have a controlling ion and a target ion. And remember again, the idea essentially is you really want to let the second ion know, that's the target qubit. You want to let that know that there was an excited state amplitude, but how the hell should that ion actually know this? And the knowing is done in such a way that you use a laser operation, and I show you that in detail, how to map the excited state amplitude of that ion to the bus, and that starts to shake, and then you just make a transition if and only if there was a motion in the bus. So this is the secret behind these things. So let's now just set the stage again for the spectroscopy. First of all, I have to talk a little bit about ion trap generics, because I realized yesterday also that people do not know what an ion trap is. An ion trap is essentially a device with which you can just fix the charged particle in free space. So suppose you had a particle sitting at the origin and it wants to escape in the direction of R. Then what you can do, you can apply a binding force that's a force proportional to minus R, of course, you're doing this with electric field, so the force is given by E times the electric field, and from that you just can really derive immediately the minus E times the gradient of a potential, so the potential is proportional to R squared. Now, from this you can just solve the Laplace equations, and from this you know that with a static field, you can never create a minimum electric field somewhere in free space. This is sometimes also referred to as Earnshaw's theorem, but essentially it's an application of the Gaussian law. If you just calculate that, does everybody see how this works? Have you done this in electrodynamics? You apply delta phi equals to zero to this potential, and then you see the three coefficients, and you can fulfill them only if the coefficients have a certain relationship. So you just get this potential. This is a DC potential plus an AC potential, and then we call this a power trap. That really, on the average, gives you then the trapping force in the center of the trap. Whereas with DC potentials, this does not work. In DC potentials, it only works, for instance, say, for instance, the radial in the longitudinal direction, say, in C. But in the radial direction, you would need an axiomagnetic field in order to make, say, a cyclotron motion to make the confinement. Then people call this a Penning trap. The equation of motion of the power trap, because we don't want to use magnetic fields here, there are also experiments with Penning traps, but I don't have the time to go into that. Then you see, this essentially is a harmonic oscillator with very one ugly term. This ugly term is time dependent, explicitly, and this is a not so easy to solve differential equation. It's called the Mathieu equation. And to cut a long story short, you find that there are, in a secular approximation, when you just average over one cycle of that stride frequency right here, you find that it can be approximated by a so-called pseudo-potential, so this is an average potential, and in that pseudo-potential you get trap frequencies, which are harmonic frequencies essentially at the first order, which are depending on the parameters, which are essentially the DC voltage and the AC voltages, and you can calculate that they are related to capital omega. These values are much smaller than 1, so this is usually much smaller than capital omega. I'll come back to real values a little later. Listen to the rock energy, don't get it. This is how it looks like, or generically. This would be the hyperboloids for a ring electrode and the cap end cap electrode. This would be a cross section, and the ion usually resides in the center. This is what you get from that spherical potential. And this is how it's realized. Usually you just have these electrode structures and you apply a laser beam diagonally through it, so you use fluorescence right here, and that's how you cool, and then the ions reside there in the center. The power trap, if you solve for it, has a stability diagram. It doesn't work for everywhere, it just works for certain AC values, so this is the DC voltage and the AC voltage. And within the diagram here, the so-called stability diagram, you can choose whatever parameters you want. Usually we stay here, right in the center, where A is close to zero, but you could also have different voltages. This is where the highest stability is achieved. And then you can approximate the motion by a harmonic oscillation of X, Y, and C, as indicated before with this relationship. But you see, there's also a modulation at the drive frequency, because in fact, there's always a time-dependent potential there. This pseudo-potential only that really creates the secular motion right here. And the motion would look like that, so you get here an oscillatory motion at this lowercase omega, which is modulated the further you are extending in reaching into this regime in space where you're away from the zero, which is the so-called micromotion. This has been observed with single aluminum particles in a trap long time ago. This trap was invented by Wolfgang Pauli in 1957, 1958, and was immediately picked up by others, as was done by Lange, and you can see that this is nicely showing this Lizard figure. This is 3D. The quantum mechanical description of that is then taken very simply. You just take that as an approximation. Usually there's different ways of explaining the quantum mechanics, and I don't want to go through all the details here. I just give you the simple but yet correct description here. So you just write down this trajectory, so this motion right here. So you just have the micro motion plus the secular motion. That's what's written here. The secular approximation holds only for these A's and QI's much smaller than 1. Let me just go back to see where this is. A is here and the Q is there. And this is the one right here, so this is not stable anymore. So anyway, the Q, in order to have this, must be smaller than 1, and usually we reside even in the lower part right here. A, this is 0.2, is also always smaller than 1. So the second approximation in this area is a very good approximation. Sorry, let's just do this. Let's take that second approximation right here. So we neglect the first order of the micromotion because we assume that this lowercase omega is then, due to that relationship, much smaller than capital omega. To give you an example, for calcium ions that we are using later on, this capital omega is on the order of about 20 megahertz, sometimes 30 megahertz. In other experiments in Boulder, they use up to 100 megahertz. These frequencies, lowercase omega, are usually on the order of about 1 megahertz, or say a few megahertz in the Boulder case. So the ratio is at least 1 to 20, 1 to 30. Then, of course, you can write down the pseudo-potential in such a way as if you had just the classical secular motion. This is the energy of the three secular motions in x, y, and z direction. And you can write this as pure harmonic motion in this this approximation. And then we can just standardly make a quantum description by replacing these things by bosonic operators. And now it's quantum mechanics. I trust that everybody knows how to quantize these things. Is that known? I hope so, because then I really have a problem if we have to go into this. So I've just replaced them by the standard notation for the bosonic operators, A dagger and A, and just rewriting things, you immediately see that this is the standard formulation of a harmonic oscillator, and this is the quantum number in, that's the number of vibrations, that's the excitation of the harmonic oscillator. So this is what we later on will see again. And with this we come to the notation that we have, of course, a two-level system, and I'll show you how the two-level system is prepared later on. The ground state and the excited state, this is the Rabi frequency which we interact, and this is the spontaneous decay right here. But of course, that two-level system sits in a harmonic trap. So in fact, if the ion is in this state, and that state, then of course it's on its own a two-level system. Because that motion is usually very small as compared to the frequencies with which the energy difference here, really, that's the coherence in the system, rotates. So we can separate these timescales. So in other words, I have a bunch of two-level systems, the two-level system at quantum number n, n minus 1, n plus 1. And this is the ladder scheme. I'll come back to that now more often. I will explain that in detail, how we deal with that and what the transitions are in this ladder scheme. Then a little bit more about the traps. This is something you've seen already before. We are using mostly this trap, but you will see later on also so-called segmented traps of this kind, and we'll come back to that. These linear traps are slightly different because there's a symmetry here about the x and y axis, and the z axis doesn't really matter because this is DC. And if you just then calculate the frequencies in omega r, this is x and y, because if we are just dealing in two dimensions, then you can rewrite the stability diagram in such a way. But again, you're usually living here in this area when we operated for this, for the quantum information processing purposes. If you really want to use this as a mass filter, for example, physical chemists do that very often, atomic physicists do that very often, then you operate it right here. So you just change, for example, the Qx and the Ax in such a way that this relationship goes, that the curve goes always through this point. If you have that point, then only a single mass can be transmitted through this mass filter. That's why it's called a mass filter. And that's the dominant use in atomic physics. And this paper where you see all the physics is contained, is available to you. If you want to look up the trap physics, just go there. You've seen that picture too. This is the one that we've been using. And again, now you understand probably more why I'm saying, for all practical purposes, this trap is a harmonic oscillator. There will be some gory details later on, because if you look precisely enough, you will see the influence of the so-called micromotion, that's the time-dependent field. But let's not worry about this at this time. So for all practical purposes, we think this is a harmonic oscillator. This is the trap as it is, and then we just look at the fluorescence, then we see the string of these 8 ions. How is this now? If you just take this linear ion trap, and if you see these strings inside, then we have rather now a collective quantized motion, because a single ion, of course, could move back and forth in three dimensions, But if you have two of them, three of them and more, they are really repelling each other. So the question really is, what happens then? And now you really have to go through all the eigenmodes of the ions, the eigenmotion. And if you just now take three or more of them, then you see there's always a center of mass mode. And if you calculate that, then you find that the first eigenmode, the first mode of that common motion, is always the same. It's like coupled pendula. So you have a pendulum, and the second one a coupled, and the third one, fourth one, and so forth. The first mode that you get is always the center of mass motion, where you're shaking back and forth. But if you have two ions in a couple, or say two coupled pendula, then you know the other eigenmotion is that one when the pendula are moving like that. And any motion can be described as a linear superposition of these two modes. Now if you add another ion, this is another pendulum, for example, because it's classical motion essentially, but we quantized it of course now, but it's still a classical motion, then you get three modes. So adding an ion or adding a pendulum adds a mode structure. And if you look for the ions, because now the repelling force is the Coulomb force, then you find the second mode would be then a breathing mode, where the second mode is a factor of square root of 3 larger than the original eigenmode. This can be calculated because you just make a balance between the Coulomb repulsion and the confining tracking force, and then you see that the inner particle distance, which is the characteristic for the confinement of the particles in the axial dimension, can be calculated here from the trap frequency. That's the standing for the confining force. And so this is a characteristic trap distance. This is typically 4.5 microns for 1 megahertz in calcium. So that sets the scale, the distance scale. If you really want to get the ions closer together, you have to squeeze further. Or if you want to get them closer apart, just make that frequency smaller. That's the usual part. And then you can calculate these eigenmodes, the eigenfrequencies, and they can be calculated analytically for the first three ones. For the other ones, you really have to do this numerically, but they go nicely up. And you see in the graphical description, here is the ion number, and these are the normal mode frequencies. You see, you add an ion, you add another mode frequency, and so forth and so forth. That's a slight dependence on the number, but it's hard to see in this picture, at least for the first 100 ions, you wouldn't see it. And likewise, you can calculate from that the positions of the ions, and we can measure these things. That works very fine. This is really a theory. That's the measurement that we did almost 15 years ago, 16 years ago, and it fits perfectly well. And also, now they can see how these ions move. This is the center of mass mode excitation. So in this case, it's 7 ions, and they are excited to undergo the center of mass motion. And here we do a stroboscopic detection. So we just flash the camera on just all the time with this frequency, which is slightly different from that motion frequency. So we just see the motion at the beat frequency. And this, you see how the entire center of mass mode moves fine. And if you look for the breathing mode, look, my pointer is working. Then you see that the breathing mode, the center particle should actually sit stock still. In this trap that we had in 1998, this was not perfect. It actually moves a little bit with it. Now the new traps don't do that. But again, this is also a very classical excitation. This is not an excitation in the quantum way where we have excite just one phonon. This is a highly excited motion with 100,000 of phonons in the system. Okay, but just to show you that these things work. And nowadays, okay, if we work with strings like that, we can work with strings up to 70. They are not so precisely controlled yet as these ones, but we can do this at least with 30 and 40 qubits precisely. Again, the Levitt scheme. This is the atomic physics now. The atomic physics is such that we have, of course, two radiations in the system, so we need, in order to see the ion, to excite resonance fluorescence, we excite that at 397, but then there's a branching ratio, maybe it's 12 to 1 cases, it decays to the D3 half state, and the D3 half state also lives about a second. So the ion would get stuck here if we do not apply that repumping laser at 866. So we have to repump that, and then it can decay, so we close the cycle. That's how we do usually laser cooling, Doppler cooling, and that's how we do then detection of the fluorescence. And this is the transition from the ground state to the excited state. That is a quadrupole transition. That quadrupole transition, that's not allowed in first order, a double approximation, so it's a quadrupole excitation in this case. It really means its lifetime is long, and lifetime is about 1 second. this is where we have to apply then a highly coherent laser. And in order to make use of that lifetime, we need to have a laser which has a bandwidth of 1 Hz. That is the hard part, it's not so easy to come by one. But we have done this, and we have several lasers now that do the trick, but we can come back to the technicalities later. And of course there's the other transition right here. We don't want to wait until this spontaneously decays, because that would be a second or so. So we have this laser available with which we can manipulate the state so that it comes back at will. Here comes the trick with which we can actually detect these things with 100% detection efficiency. And the reason is here that for a single ion we have such a 3-level system. This is the forbidden transition. If we routinely scatter photons right here, then, of course, we see fluorescence. But once this state gets occupied, this electron, because it's a single atom, is no longer available to scatter light here. And that really means the light switches off. These are the famous observations of quantum jumps that we observed in the middle of the 80s. And you can use that number of quantum jumps that you observe as a function of frequency, for instance, to do precision spectroscopy. That's how modern ion clocks work these days. And you see, this is a very long time. This trace was obtained in a barium ion, a single barium ion, which lives slightly longer. The lifetime is about 40 seconds. You see, there are windows here which last 20 seconds. And this is fairly amazing for an atom. It has an excited state at electron volt excitation, which doesn't decay. But the point simply is, when you now just flash in the light right here in this transition and look for these jumps, you see either light or you don't see light. And that gives rise to that histogram. If you just look here at the counts that you see in a certain time interval, this is a very old measurement, you can do this a lot faster these days, then you see that if you don't see anything, just background light, you know prior to application of the light, the ground state was occupied. But if you see the light, and that's a Poissonian histogram, then you see, yes, the excited state was occupied, this ground state is occupied. So you just draw an electronic line in the computer that discriminates between the ground state here and the excited state population, and with this you get a detection efficiency of 99.85%, and with the newer measurements we get 999 in the few ninth year. So it's for practical purposes, it's 100% detection efficiency. That's a technology which is not available in most other quantum systems. This is why trapped ions are really so useful to demonstrate these things. Now comes a little harder part. For those who have quantum mechanics, it's easy, but let me just walk you through it, and I see we are running out of time probably. We'll see how this goes. Now, we have this ion sitting in a harmonic well, and now you've seen we have at least our two-level system. I'll show you how to prepare the two-level system a little later, but believe me, for a second, we have the two-level system. And now we want to describe these things. So we just have our atom, and now we have the interaction, bless you. So we just have now, say, the kinetic term, this is the trap potential, and this is the internal degree of freedom that we have there. And I can rewrite this now in terms of the raising and lowering operators, and this is now the fields that I've written down here in the interaction. So this is the interaction term, where these are wave number, frequency, phase, the laser energy, and the mass of the ion. And these are just now the Pauli operators that we have. Pauli matrices are well known. Okay? Good. And you will find all the notation here in this paper if you really want to look at it. Now, there's a very important parameter, and this parameter is called the Lamb-Dicke parameter. Essentially, it's just the extension of the ion in the ground state of the harmonic well, harmonic oscillator, you can just calculate that, then the width of the wave packet of the ground state, that's the x naught, and that's just given by h bar over 2m omega naught, and this is to be multiplied by the wavelength of the incoming radiation. This is what we call a Lamb-Dicke parameter. And if you write this out right now, then you can see in terms of the creation annihilation operators I've seen before, and we can then really write this in a longer term. Then you see this is the k times x that we had before here, in this case. This is what we do now. And we rewrite this in terms of the Lamb-Dicke parameter, this is kx naught, times the excitation. Well, we are really now doing harmonic oscillator physics. Have the raising operator, lowering operator for the atom, and this is the phase of the laser radiation. And then we go to an interaction picture that we define here by this Hamiltonian, so we just go into the rotating system, and we obtain the Hamiltonian right here. And then the interaction Hamiltonian gets to this. want you to go through these things carefully, maybe afterwards, but these things do you know from a standard quantum mechanics course. It's easy enough to follow these things. And then, of course, we go to another rotating frame where we just go to the frame where this rotates with omega at this point. And then we just see that we have various states of the harmonic oscillators that couple with each other. So the decoupling states, the Negron state with n, and the excited state with n prime. Remember the level scheme that we have, the ladder scheme. So there are different vibrational levels n and n prime, and we have different internal excitations at the Negron state, that's the excited states. Again, we're back to this picture here. So we have n quantum numbers of the harmonic oscillator, we have a Negron state and excited state, and now we can couple with the various tunings these individual two level systems. If we do not have a width of these states, which you can forget, think of the level width as about 1 Hz, and the distance between these levels is about 1 MHz, so you can essentially forget about any width of the states. There's no width here. In other words, you have only these resonant conditions, or in experimental terms, these systems can be treated as all two level systems that you have here independently, because when you drive this one, you do not drive that one, and vice versa. Now, when we tune now the laser close to one of these resonances between n and n plus m, between the Negron state and the excited state, then we can couple only to that resonance because we have that condition. We do not couple to any other resonance here. In other words, the time evolution can be then described by pairwise coupled states, so this number of two level systems that we couple in pairwise fashion. And then, of course, we can calculate the dynamical evolution but these coupled equations, as you would ordinarily do for a single two-level system, but we just calculate it out for the entire system of two-level systems. Then we introduce the detuning to the respective state, m, which is just the difference from the n right here, and just define now the respective Rabi frequency between states omega n and omega n plus m, and this is just given by the ordinary Rabi frequency between the state, as indicated here, times this factor. This is sometimes called, according to molecular physics, a Debye-Waller factor, but it doesn't really matter. This is a factor, a matrix element that you get from the harmonic oscillator potential. And then, of course, when we just look for the Rabi oscillations, as is indicated here, now on resonance we get for the various Rabi oscillations this kind of an expression. Now let's reduce this to the so-called Lamb-Digger regime. Then we have small oscillation amplitudes. That really means that the parameter eta squared is usually small. Remember, eta was the ratio of the extension of a wave packet in the Negron state divided by the wavelength. For 1 MHz secular frequency of calcium, that extension of the Negron state is about 7 nanometers. And the wavelength is roughly about 700 nanometers, so it's about 1%. This is typically the eta that we have here. In other words, the n could go up to about 50 or so until this really meets 1. If we are low down in the excitation of the harmonic oscillator, then this approximation holds, and we can replace this factor, the exponential factor, e to the I eta times a dagger plus a, by this series, and we forget about that term. So we just make this linear approximation. And then, of course, we can just plug in that approximation into the former numbers that we have, and then we get the respective Rabi frequencies between between terms of even n. So you see, this is the one, and that's a very small contribution that we get to this, and we usually neglect that, but we can also make use of it. But this is the term which is usually unperturbed. Then the interaction Hamiltonian that can be approximated by a simple consideration. We have the so-called carrier excitation that doesn't change the n quantum number right here. So this is the one that we have. Or if we just go to n minus 1, that is in the ladder scheme, we just make an excitation from here to the left-hand side. We are short by one frequency of the secular motion. Then we get, due to the Bose factors that enter here, this eta times square root of n term at this point. And on the other side, we get the so-called blue sideband, and we get, of course, the square root of n plus 1 term due to the Bose factors here times omega. These are the Hamiltonians that are now important. This is the carrier, this is the red sideband excitation, and that's the blue sideband excitations. And for those who know about quantum optics already, they may realize this is a Hamiltonian that is very well known in quantum optics. Does anybody know what Hamiltonian that is, what I'm referring to?
James Cummings.
Yes, this is the so-called James Cummings Hamiltonian. It's the same thing as if you couple a two-level system, for instance, to the radiation in the cavity. Because the radiation in the cavity, the field, is also then approximated by a harmonic oscillator. We just replace the harmonic oscillator here by the trap oscillator and not by the optical field in the cavity. When in the future we also apply the trapped ion inside the cavity, we will have a double James Cummings Hamiltonian, so you can play with all these tricks. That's getting yet more complicated. But otherwise, the underlying physics is simple. And this is what we now restrict ourselves to. We always consider only these three points in the spectrum, in spite of the fact that experimentally we initially observed many more sidebands. But of course, this is what we want to do, so for this reason, and to make this land thicker small, because they make the end small right here, to keep that approximation right, we need to cool the system down as much as we can. Okay, here we are. These are now the interactions in the ladder structure. You've seen that, and I repeat this as often as I can, because this is very important that you get the point here. When you make these excitations, then this is the carrier. It has this small contribution, so even when you make a transition of the carrier and you have a very high excitation on N, you actually can see that there is motion in the picture. And we use this sometimes to determine for a hot ion what the motion really is. But usually when we are cooled down, it's just this term that contributes, because that's negligible. Then there's the red sideband, and this is the sideband where we just change the vibration by one, but like at the same time we just increase, of course, make a transition from G to the excited state E, the internal excitation. And this is the blue sideband, where we just increase the vibration quantum number here, and then make an excitation to the excited state. So the red and blue sidebands involve simultaneously a change in the vibration, quantum number, and in the internal degree of freedom. So there's no way that you can just change in a single step only the vibration quantum number, but not the internal degree of freedom. So we always, at least not with these transitions. These are the basic transitions that we are using. So these are the three ones I've just shown you. And when I'm referring to these transitions, and I'll come back to them many, many times, these are the basic operations. And here are now, this is now written in terms of rotations. When we talk about these rotations on the Bloch sphere, you see that written here, then we apply these rotational notation. So we have rotations about the angle theta and phi, and then we apply the interaction Hamiltonian right here on the carrier, then for a certain time t, then this is the Rabi frequency on the carrier times the interaction time t, and that rotates it about the angle theta, of course, with the phase of the laser phi. The phase is just what the phase is in the plane of the coherence. That's the phase right here, that's the optical phase that we have. And this is the angle theta from the z-axis by how much you tilt your Bloch vector. And that depends, as we saw from the Rabi oscillations, it depends on the time it takes you apply that radiation. This is why you have to multiply this, and that's the phase it accumulates. The same is true for the other sideband, for the other transitions. Remember, we are effectively dealing with now isolated two-level systems. It's all two-level system physics. And this isolated two-level system on the red side, and of course, goes with the Lamb-Dicker parameter, so it just goes smaller. It's the different Rabi frequency. It's less fast, and so that's the Rabi frequency on the sideband. And the same notation holds. The same is true on the blue sideband. But of course, they make now a simultaneous change of the internal degree of freedom and the external degree of freedom. So these are the entangling operations that we need in order to convey the information. This is the formal description of what I've been alluding to when I was describing these operations. And this is now the level system as it is, essentially, just to remind you, bless you, and we are always dealing with that laser, and that laser is supposed to be very narrowband, because that's really manipulating the system at will. But of course, I was always assuming that we had a two-level system. again, there is nothing like a two-level system. If you look very closely at it, this is the system as it is. And if you just apply a small magnetic field, then you see there's two states in the ground state, half volt to doublet, and there's the five half states, so there's six states in the excited state. So there's our two-level system. What's the interaction? Now, we just looked at in a spectral decomposition, then you see there's 10 different transitions possible because of the selection rules that you have here, which are indicated here. What we usually do initially is we just single out that two-level system, one half to five half. I'll come back later to a different two-level system, I can already say it, because that is heavily depending on the magnetic field, because of the Clebsch-Gordan coefficient. We rather use for quantum information processing this one, which goes from minus one half to minus one half up here. But let me just do this by telling you about the two-level system that we really try to make. And this is the system as we have it. And the question is, how do we actually get that two-level system? And you see, the two-level system that we single out is this one. This can be done spectroscopically, for example, by using all the other transitions that we have to do optical pumping with the right polarizations to that state one half. But from the state one half, there's now five transitions available to the excited state, so it would be five two-level systems. But again, if you just make the transition only with sigma plus light, then by selection rules, all the other transitions are ruled out. So experimentally, and for all practical purposes, we have now a real two-level system that we are using, because that system can decay only back to plus one half and not to minus one half. Okay? This is the actually atomic physics trick, how to single out a two-level system. You can do that with others as well, but that's a bit more tricky because then you have to make sure that there's no leak when we just go to that one. So let's stick to this transition first because that's easy to see. Now, how do we make now the spectroscopy? Think of it. I just remind you over and over again of this. Our two-level system is now written in Dutcher term, and we have now all the various transitions available. If you're sticking to the Lamb-Dicker regime, and this can be reached by doing the cooling. Cooling in the system can be achieved by Doppler cooling first, by going to the lower half of the width of the transition, and then ordinary cooling, and I'll come back to that in a minute. Then we do sideband cooling, I'll come back to that one too, but you just tune the laser here, it climbs down all the way until you reside in the state N equals zero. Then you're just left, as I told you before, because you're now in the Lamb-Dicker regime, with three transitions, that the carrier transition, the red sideband, and the blue sideband. So in a spectral decomposition, you have to live only with these three transitions. Others, if you're really cold, do not contribute. Can we measure this? How do we do this? Now this is the experimental cycle. First of all, we prepare the state, as indicated by optical pumping. Then we probe the state with this laser at 729 nanometers, for say between 5 microseconds and 3 milliseconds, depending on what resolution you want to have. And then we invoke quantum charge spectroscopy. As I told you before, we're just asking, did the system make a transition, or then this level should not be radiating, or is this up there, then it should, of course, if it's up there, then it's dark, or if it's bright, then it's in the ground state. So we apply these two radiations to the system. And if the system is in the D5 half state, of course, it can't scatter light, but if it's in the ground state, it does scatter light. So we detect fluorescence for a certain amount of time. And then we repump the system, do Doppler cooling, and start over again. So we repeat this 100 or 1,000 times, and then we make an average, ordinary quantum optics measurement. And the cycle time looks like that. So we just have here, for ordinary Doppler cooling, this is the pumping to make sure that we get the right substrate right here. Then we apply this laser all the time, the 866, to make sure that nothing resides in the D3 half level. Then we apply, of course, the 854 transition to make sure that if there was anything left in D5 half level, it also goes down. Then we apply the 729 nanometer radiation, and then we just excite or we don't excite, and then finally we detect, and then we repeat the entire cycle. This is automatically done, typically about 50 times a second, sometimes 100 times a second, depending if we do this. And very often we trigger this, is also an experimental trick, with a 50 Hertz line frequency. Why is that? 50 Hertz line frequency, of course, causes fluctuations of the magnetic field, because there is currents flowing everywhere. So in principle, when you look at your magnetic field, the magnetic field fluctuates slightly at a rate of about 50 hertz up and down, because it's very hard to shield. Nowadays we are using new metal shields to even reduce that. And this transition is first order Zeeman dependent, so it's a first order Zeeman effect. So it will always change its frequency slightly according to the 50 hertz field. But since we are triggering out the phase of the 50 hertz line frequency, you're always looking at the same field. So we are just avoiding that shift by this, the Zeeman shift by the line frequency that we have. And then we just make a spectroscopy and see readily such a forest of transitions. Remember, that's a single ion. A single ion sitting there shows such a rich spectrum. Why is that? Now, first of all, you see there's five transitions because we sorted out the transition minus 5 half, and then plus 5 half, 5 half, and it always goes from here to the other ones. So the plus 1 half to minus 3 halves, and so that's this manifold, and then these manifolds are overlapping. Each transition has a sideband structure, which is due to the vibration. And if I'm not exactly in the Lambdicke regime, then there's a sideband structure which is richer than just plus or minus first sideband. And they're all overlapping. That's why you get, usually when you just make spectroscopy first, such a forest. Now you have to make a job right, and you see this is the strongest transition in the case, so you single out that yellow transition here and concentrate on that one. Then we see this is the carrier, and these are the red sidebands and the blue sidebands. In this case we have the axial and the radial sidebands, and so this is now what we see in a, this is actually taken in a trap which is called a spherical trap. Here the axial sidebands are further away than the radial sidebands. This is just the reverse in the linear trap, but otherwise it's exactly the same thing. And sometimes we even see these little resonances because we're very sensitive in spectroscopy. This is due to some mixtures of higher order frequencies that actually generate a coupling, but this can be reduced. So in the end, when we just look for a linear ion drop, we find the carrier in the spectrum, we find the axial mode, the red sideband, and the axial mode, the blue sideband. These three transitions are actually used for quantum information processing. Then there are radial modes, and they are used for stuff that we are using now in simulations. And there are some spurious resonances because this is a high excitation, they usually do not contribute. This is how we set the system into action. So we have to calibrate this all the time. And the system is self-calibrating all the time. It's automatically doing this with a computerized program. There's three computers steering the system, observing this with the camera, and really automatically generating all the basics, because we don't want to go over this all over and over again. Otherwise the system is too complicated. And now we just concentrate on these three transitions to make the compression. Now before I go on, I would have to show you something, and as you see there's an A right here, because I realized some of the basics are not there. So I want to give you the ideas about laser cooling. What is laser cooling about? This is generic transparency about laser cooling of atoms. Laser cooling of atoms, so free atoms works in such a way, so you have a cloud of atoms, for example, and they have a velocity distribution. Some of these atoms are moving towards the laser, some of them move away or have a vector component. But now we detune the laser below resonance. And that detuning can be matched by the respective Doppler shift when the atoms are moving towards the laser. So for a certain detuning, predominantly those atoms which match this actually get excited. When they do this, then there's momentum transfer right here from the incoming radiation, and then there's the emitted the radiation, so the scattering force. On the average, of course, this is upon spontaneous emission. Really, the momentum transfer happens in 4 pi space, and this averages out, as indicated here. So the average momentum transfer after many of those is about, it's just from the absorbed photons that come in there. So the average momentum transfer is then given by the number of photons absorbed times the absorbing k vector rate. So for example, for a typical atom, this is on the order of 1 cm/s you do as a momentum transfer per absorption. And the Doppler cooling limit is when you go to the life, the half width of the line width right here, is about h bar gamma over 2. That's a typical Doppler limit that you get for 2 level systems. This holds for 3 level systems as well, although it's a bit more difficult, because in 3 level systems, when you apply 2 lasers simultaneously, and we have actually an 8 level system here, then you get so-called dark resonances, so you have to be much more careful. I don't have the time to go into these things, so So this has been investigated in the 80s at length to understand what's going on there. And we know these things, but the Doppler cooling limit is pretty similar. Now, what is the cooling of trapped atoms? It doesn't only hold for a trapped ion, but also for trapped atoms. But you have to understand that we now have our system, which is a two-level system, is sitting in a trap again. This is again the same scheme as always. So this is the radiations that we can apply to the system. But we distinguish now two different schemes and regimes that we have. And you want to look up the literature for that. These are the reviews that point that out. If you have a so-called weak confinement, then the trap frequency that I've indicated here, the distance between these two trap states, that's the vibrational distance, if that is much smaller than the width of that state, then of course the system cannot really distinguish whether it absorbs from here or there, because then this limit is wide enough to accept all of these. We call this then weak confinement, and in the end what you get is exactly the Doppler cooling limit. One can show this, you can find this in both of these references. This is where you get the h bar gamma over 2, provided that you have, say, this weak confinement condition, then you are always in the regime where you end up with the quantum number of the harmonic oscillator, which is much larger than 1. Typically, to give you a number, for calcium and the width of the excited state of about 20 megahertz, you would end up in an average quantum state between 15 and 18, somewhat there. So the excitation would be 15 or 18, the quantum numbers in the vibrational mode. So you would not be able to see any difference here. So in order to do now sideband cooling, you have to go to the so-called strong confinement. Strong confinement requires that this picture holds. This picture holds only when you can spectroscopically decompose the two-level systems. Again, we are talking about the two-level systems that we are manipulating, but now we are adding another time constant, or actually bandwidth right here. This is the width of these excited states. If your frequency difference between these two vibrational states is larger than the bandwidth right here, then of course you can spectroscopically distinguish between all of these excitations. And then you can tune that laser, for example, explicitly from here to there and not to this one. Whereas if you have this case, you just tune the laser here and all of these things get excited. So when you do the sideband cooling then, and you tune it here, then it decays down, it goes to the ground state as indicated, then you really reach that level that is n, the average n is smaller than 1, and this is actually the real limit of the sideband cooling. But this is what's called then the strong confinement limit. Just to give you a pictorial representation, if we have the strong confinement limit right here, then under this limit we can spectroscopically distinguish all of these states. We can single out that, and then we indeed reach the ground state. If on the other hand, we cannot spectroscopically distinguish between this one and that one, because when we excite here, there's also some excitation here and there, then there's transitions down there, there's transitions up here. So on average, we smear out the entire system, and then we end up in a much higher state in the quantum harmonic oscillator as we would do otherwise. That's the difference in laser cooling for the systems, and you really have to single out the regimes. Now, the difficulty is with the calcium, that level that we have here, that would be the excited state, is normally a P state. That P state has a line width of 20 megahertz, and you remember the harmonic oscillator frequency was only 1 megahertz. So with that transition, you're automatically in the weak confinement limit. You would not be able to do sideband cooling. So we had to invent a technique to go to sideband cooling. What we did instead is now the following. We know the transition between S1/2 and P1/2, that is a very narrow one, but it doesn't decay heavily. So we just could not, we would have to wait for an eternity to come down to the ground state. So what we do instead is the following. We just excite that narrow transition, excite then the quenching transition from D5/2 to P3/2 and end up in the ground state. And we can adiabatically eliminate this P3/2 state because its lifetime is negligibly short, and we end up with an effective two-level system, and one can calculate that, and this is the effective cooling rate. This is work we did in the 90s to prepare for all of these things. Well, this is how we do the effective sideband cooling in our system. And how do we measure that? Now suppose you have this two-level system that you have, and the thickness of the lines should indicate now the population in the system. once you have done optical pumping and you have really reached the grand state is most heavily populated. There's a little bit in the first excited state, and then the third one, these are the vibration levels. How do you see that? Now, then you make spectroscopy. Then you look, for example, at the excitation from zero to zero in the excited state. Yes, there's much here, so we hopefully can see something. But of course, you also see something when you go to one. Of course, there's a lambda parameter involved, but you would see it. But if you tune to the lower side band right here, there's no equivalent. There's just no chance that you see something. There must be an asymmetry. And of course, you have to sum up with that population right here, and then you get the spectrum. And to sum here, but that doesn't contribute much. Then eventually you see a spectrum that is the lower sideband, the carrier, and the upper sideband. And if the lower sideband, of course, is much smaller than the upper sideband, then you know, okay, apparently most of my population is down there in the ground state, there's nothing here left, I can't excite that. I know what the population is, and you can calculate that. And these are the populations in the ground state, and this is the average quantum numbers that you get from these amplitudes. And this is how we measure sideband cooling. We quantify it, and that works in the experiment nicely. So this is, for instance, done after Doppler cooling. We see a slight asymmetry because after Doppler cooling, we gave it a chance and we made a very good job. It is already close to the ground state, but not really in the ground state. But when we really apply sideband cooling, then it completely vanishes. This is one of the preparatory steps that we had to take even before we could do the manipulation, because if we want to know, yes, I'm down in the ground state, think of the Cirac solar idea that required to be in the ground state. This is one of the decisive steps. Now, another step that's necessary in order to do this, we need to address UVT lines. Think of the picture that we had. We take that picture. This is the pictures are taken with the camera. There's a lens right here, and we take a CCD picture. Now we know that apparently we can see these pictures, so the lens has good imaging qualities and is able to resolve all these things. We make use of that, then we go back with another beam, say the manipulation beam, that's the 729 nanometer beam, go through an electro-optic deflector and say a microscope enlargement system, we blow the beam up and have a beam splitter right here and use the same beam path backwards. So we focus the entire system through the observation lens right here. This is a dichroic beam splitter, so it is reflecting for this red infrared, the infrared radiation, but it's transmitting for the blue radiation that goes to the CCD camera. And with this electro-optic deflector, we just can apply a voltage and shift the beam laterally back and forth. So in fact, we can just move the beam focus from here to there, to there, to there, to there. And then you see, actually, we see nice Gaussian beam widths at the site where the ions are, and we see there's not much overlap, and we can individually excite these ions. So we know the inter-ion distance is roughly about 4 micron. The addressing base in this experiment was about 2.5 micron. In the meantime, we have improved things. We're on the order of about 1 micron here, so we have a real good beam base, and we can really individually ions address these ions without addressing the neighboring ions. That's not what we want, of course. And then, when you just take a shot with the camera system, of course we do not wait then to get all these nice pictures, because that would take too long a time. Here we just take a few milliseconds or even less than that, and we just take shots of pictures so we know exactly where the ions are. We bin pixels, and the binning of 3x3 pixels, for example, gives you then the information. You count all the counts here, and then you conclude all the ions are radiating, so they're all in the S state. Or this one's radiating, there's nothing here. This one's radiating, nothing here, and so forth. And from this you can conclude, and that's what the computer does. There's a computer operating the camera, it does nothing else. It just takes, after a few milliseconds, a picture. When it's told to take that from the master computer, it just does the measurement and concludes what's the state vector of the computer. Well, this is how we derive the system and then do the measurements. Now let's come to the single qubit operations. You've seen that picture before. Now you understand it in a much better way. These are the Rabi oscillations that I've shown you before. Now we do this here first on the carrier transition. The carrier transition is a strong transition in our notation. So we just do not change the vibration quantum number. So we go up and down all the time. This goes on a few thousand times. So this is the Rabi flopping as indicated right here. And you see here, okay, we can just go up, go down, and the time it takes for the two pi pulses is roughly about 10 or 11 microseconds. It's a little faster these days, but it's about the same time. But when we single out the other two level system right here, then we just have to take into account that the Rabi frequency is modified by the harmonic oscillator that's of course in there, and that of course is governed by the Lambdicke parameter 16.4. Well, that's a slow because there's a motion involved, and of course we change the motional degree of freedom and the internal degree of freedom. And here you see that this goes much slower. It's typically 200 microns in this case. It also depends a little bit on the angle under which we apply the laser beam. That can be modified, but not by much. You see, it's typically a factor of 100, in this case 200, factor between them. But these are the two only operations that we usually use. And here you can see again the same thing that I wrote here. And I just make on the carrier now the transition, but I just apply only a pi over 2 pulse. What happens is, then at this time, when I stop things here, then I leave the system in a coherent superposition between ground state and excited state. That's how I create a superposition. Or if I stop here, then of course I have transferred the population from S to D. This is what we call a pi pulse. The same happens here. If I just stop at this point, then of course I've made a simultaneous transition from S0 to D1. So I get that transition. But writing this does not allow me to write this expression, this superposition, in a separate way where only the internal degrees of freedoms are and the external degrees of freedoms are. This inseparability is indeed entanglement. That's what we call entanglement. So this is the entangling operation I've talked about. Or you can simply transfer the system from S0 to D1. That's a pi pulse. There's no entanglement right here, but this is the entangling transition that we actually have. Okay, now we're almost ready to do the computations. Let's just go back to the Cirac solar again. That's because that's pedagogically, I think it's all there is. Because Mimmer Sørensen that we do later on are slightly more complicated, but essentially, since they're using the motion, the physics is already contained here. Cirac solar, we are back to the same picture that we had. Now we are trying to realize now this C0 gate operation by all these individual gates and the addressing notation. So we want to make sure that we rewrite the population from the excited state to the ground state right here and add 1. You know now precisely what operations are necessary in order to do that. And then we just want to make a transition if and only if there was motion in the system, then we go back. And this is realized here. For this experiment, we just loaded more than 10 years ago just 2 ions side by side, about 5 microns. And here we do first the following. First of all, we swap the information on whether the system is in excited or in ground state to the motion. After we swap the system, then the information is in the superposition between the ground state and the first excited vibrational state, because the internal degree of freedom is now always in the ground state. Now we just make that C0 gate operation. I'll come back to that in a minute. This is just a shorthand notation, as you know now. And finally, we go back, we make the unswap operation, so we just take things back to the first ion at the internal degree of freedom, and the motion is left in 0. In other words, the motion usually is only involved in the Cirac solar notation later on, and the Mimmer Sørensen notation as well, during the gate operation. Before and after, the motional state is supposedly unchanged. Of course, everything works only so well, and there might be errors, and we come back to that. But this is the idea how it's supposed to work. And the procedure here is the following. We just map things with the pi pulse, because we have to map the information on the bus or the motion, whether there's an excited state or not. We start with the phase 0, and eventually we map things back with the phase pi, because we really want to swap things here, and then we just undo what we did before, so we have to change the phase as well. And now the point simply is, how do we actually do the C0 gate operation? And this is a bit more tricky. I would suggest that I continue here, and if you really have the question, or we can actually break in, I'll show you how to do these concatenated operations right now. But it's going to take me a little while. What would you prefer? But you want me to, let me go on and I'll come in the back and explain these details. First of all, these 4 blue things, it's so-called dance on the block sphere. These are 4 pulses that change just the phase of the entire wave function by a factor of -1. So in principle, when you have the system with the pi pulse mapped on the bus, then you go to the second ion and make, say, a 2-pi rotation. A 2-pi rotation is just adding a factor of minus 1 in the global phase of the wave function. 4-pi would be just +1 again in the Bloch sphere. After all, it's a two-level system, like a spin 1/2 particle. So a 2-pi rotation is a minus sign, a global phase of -1. But how does the system recognize that there is a phase change of -1? And that's undone with the so-called that phase is really rewritten into a population with a Ramsey pulse. A Ramsey pulse does the following: we just start off with a pi over 2 pulse on the carrier, and we end up with a pi over 2 pulse on the carrier. Does everybody know what Ramsey spectroscopy is? I haven't talked about this so far. Who does not know what Ramsey spectroscopy is? Okay, so I'll have to make a break here because that is important. Ramsey spectroscopy was invented by Norman Ramsey. He was actually a student of Rabi, and was invented in the early 50s. Ramsey spectroscopy makes use of the fact that you want to excite the gain in two-level system. And you have a ground state and an excited state. If you do excite the two-level system and you just want to make spectroscopy, what do you do? Spectroscopy always means you just draw the excitation of the excited states population as a function of the detuning. So you just tune the laser, for instance, a little bit below, and then you just go across, and then this is the delta omega that you're at, and this is what I'm drawing here. What would you expect? What you do usually, if you do Ramsey spectroscopy, do a so-called Rabi spectroscopy, you just apply a pulse with a time t. Okay? A pulse with a time t, and think of this as transition. There's no spontaneous decay here. If there were a spontaneous decay, which is, say, if the system were to decay very fast, and faster than the excitation rate here, then everything that I just produce in the excited state would immediately decay. Then what I usually would get would be a profile which is either a Doppler profile, or I would get, say, the Lorentzian profile if I'm Doppler free. But not, we are not doing this. We are taking now a two-level system which doesn't decay, for example. And then we just apply the radiation only for a time t. If you apply the radiation for a time t, then you're looking for the spectral response of this one. This is the same thing as if you go through a slit and look for diffraction pattern in the far field. What you get as a line shape is something like this. And this is called Rabi spectroscopy. And this is the line width that you get here, and that's of course limited by the interaction time that you apply. Now, the point simply is, this was done with atomic beams, so you just have a preparation stage A, a detection stage C, and then B, and then the interaction part C, it's called the C field in the center. Then the atoms fly through that magnetic field, the interaction part, and then there could be inhomogeneities, and they have to be coherent to the entire time. And that was already limiting the spectroscopic resolution in those days. Ramsey said, okay, in fact, if I just take now my two-level system, remember what happens. If I just replace this here, instead by a sequence, which I just have first a pi over 2 pulse, wait a certain amount tr, and have another pi over 2 pulse. What happens? If my two-level system holds, my first pi over 2 pulse puts the system in the coherence plane, the system starts to process in the coherence plane with its eigenfrequency, which is just the energy gap between the two-level system. And then, of course, after a certain amount of delay time, the system comes by and then experiences the second pi over 2 pulse. If that first pi over 2 pulse is exactly in phase with the precession, then, of course, it concludes the pi pulse and it just excites the system. But if it happens to be on the other side, then it just goes in that direction and turns things down. So, in other words, the line shape that you're expecting in Ramsey spectroscopy, when you go over it, and we are just now taking this part, is of course the overall envelope that we have, and this is then something like this. It gets modulated. So the overall line shape is what we get by Rabi, but the internal part here is giving by this delay time, that's why TR, that's why I call Ramsey. And if you just take this out here, this part, then you would simply see something like that, which is more or less a sinusoidal variation, and you get a higher resolution. The central part here has a line width which is much narrower than this one. The line width is only determined by TR. So this is what we call Ramsey spectroscopy. This is the method that's usually used for all atomic beams, for frequency standards, for cesium standards, rubidium standards, and everything else that we use these days. This is what we call Ramsey spectroscopy. It's using pi over 2 pulses instead of the usual interaction time t for Rabi spectroscopy. Because then here I have a free position, I don't have to make the interaction zone very long, just 2 pulses. This is why Norman Ramsey got the Nobel Prize in 1989. And we do the same thing here. This is essentially the leading pi over 2 pulse, and this is the trailing pi over 2 pulse. We just want to make sure that the phases are really kept, so we just have a phase 0 and a phase pi right here. This is just for to make the signs right. And now what's left over are these 4 pulses in the center. These 4 pulses, and I'll show you that afterwards because it's a bit more complicated, they do the trick. Instead of having, say, a 2 pi pulse, in principle it would be sufficient to add a 2 pulse if the system were very excited in the first vibration state. So you just want to make a 2 pi pulse, and you could do that by just adding, say, in the latter scheme, say, a red side band and make, say, a 2 pi rotation on this one. Then you would end up with the 2 pi pulse, and that would just give you a minus sign to the entire wave function. You're breaking this 2 pi pulse, a single 2 pi pulse, in these 4 pulses. And let me just postpone this to a little after, because that really takes another 5 minutes. Believe me, that does the same thing, but it's called concatenated pulse technique, and we borrowed this from NMR, because this is a well-known technique, but I'll show you why a little later. So in the end, what it does is now we have a leading pulse that maps the information on whether the system is in the excited state on the bus, at the motion, and finally it takes it back. Then we want to make sure that we change phases into populations, so we have a leading and a trailing Ramsey pulse, and this is the pulse sequence that makes actually the minus sign if and only if there was a motion in the bus. I'll come back to that a little later. And these are the notations, so the laser frequency is blue, and this blue sideband, the pulse length, and the optical phase. And when you go through it, then of course you start out with 2 ions, so this is the population, and this is a function of time. Then you start the ground state, of course, then if you want to have the first ion there, you just make a pi pulse and map it. Then the second ion is supposed to be controlled, and then you start the pi over 2 pulse and end up at 50%. Then you start with this dance on the plosphere and make an oscillation. I'll come back to this funny shape right here. This is really a calculation, not a fit. And then finally you do the trailing pi over 2 pulse, and then you end up again zero, slight errors. And we analyze these things by checking the system initially. This is 2 ions in the S state, 1 in the S, 1 in the D state, D, S in the D, D state. So the gate sequence is applied for a certain amount of time. Then we interrupt it, and then we measure the states. We can do this with all 4 of these states and measure the truth table. And here's the truth table. And you see, the truth table is exactly the C-NOT gate operation. In other words, when the D state is occupied, we flip the states. There are some errors, and we can really check that out. We can determine the overlap between the ideal and the experimental state. It's also it's kind of a fidelity. It's the overlap in this case. And then it gives you a value, in this case, about 75-80%. You can do more. Now you can use that superposition as an input to the C-NOT gate operation. Goodness. If you just take this as an input for the first ion, it moves the ion to a superposition of D and S. Now what happens is the following, that C0 gate operation does the following, because everything is coherent. That part would render the S state to become a D state, and the S state doesn't control things, so S and S stay the same, but it would generate that system. And that system is already one of the built states. So the C0 gate operation entangles. Not the Z, not just a single ion with a vibration, but the C0 gate operation, because it's between two ions, makes a real entanglement, it generates a belt state. And you see the four different truth tables can be described in terms of a real description of the dance on the Bloch sphere, and you can measure that. And the outcome is simply that you do not observe any state DS, but you always observe the outcome is both in DD or both in SS. There's nothing like this. There's zero probability. So in other words, we experimentally confirm that there is not only the probabilities that match the truth table of the C0 gate operation, but also the coherences that match this. This is confirmed with such a measurement. Yes, now the question really is, I'm not sure I can go on and show you how to make entanglement and how to do it, or do you rather want, because we have another 10 or 15 minutes, do you rather want to hear first how we do these four gates in between the dance and the Bloch sphere? You choose. So what do you think is best? The entanglement. Let's start with that one, and if you really have questions, I'm here. We can also talk about this over lunch. I know this is difficult because you never heard about this manipulation of two-level systems, but I'd rather go through the details here, and this I think is more important than the core details which is known from NMR. So let's not just do this. You've seen that by creating that superposition of the first ion, that creates then with the C0 gate this belt state. And of course, by changing locally the phase of any one of them, I can just change to any basis, local rotations, I can just create any of these belt states that are there. Now the question really is, how do I check that I have such a belt state? Now belt state, we'll come back to that later, if you have the time, we could do tomography, and I could go at length to the tomography procedure. But there's a spectroscopic procedure, and that's the same I alluded to already during my talk on the colloquium. And this is, again, it's what I call super Ramsey spectroscopy. And you learn now what Ramsey spectroscopy means. It's just cutting one pulse and two pulses with a long delay time. And so measuring phases is done with a single ion in such a way that you have a pi over two pulse, so you set the system into a coherence plane, then you wait for a certain amount of time, and then you create another pi over two pulse of the phi, phase phi. Whether you wait and change the waiting time, or whether you just apply another pi over two pulse to a different phase, doesn't really matter. So what you do is now, you just created the system rotates, and after a fixed time, you just apply the second phase with a different phase, and no matter where the particle is, it just goes up all the time. So you see a sinusoidal signal. So you're checking the coherence of the system, that's measuring the phase of the system. This is a Ramsey experiment. But now, when we add the second ion, as we did now by using that operation, we make that C0 gate operation and take, now, although we didn't do anything here, then of course they should be able to march in lockstep because they got correlated. Now we check the phase here as well. That phase had nothing to do with that one, but if the phase is synchronized with what we have here, and we just measure both of them, we should be able to see twice as fast the phase as we had before, because they are really going in lockstep. And this is what's done here. So we create now that superposition, we generate that belt state, and we measure this, and at this time we accumulate what is called a parity. So we ask ourselves, how often do we see both of the systems in the D state, or how often do we see the system both in the S state? And we add those even contributions, and we subtract all the odd contributions, which are whenever we observe one ion in the S state and the other one in the D state, and vice versa. And then you can show that this now oscillates twice as fast. This is what you see here. Although we change the phase only about 2 pi, you see twice the change right here. And the twice phase change already hints to the fact there's two particles involved, so there's two particle entanglement. And if there were n particles involved, it would be n particle entanglement. It would be going faster. And the fidelity can be rid of the visibility. That's why I call it spectroscopic way of doing this. The visibility is always a spectroscopic measure of doing things and can be calculated from the population and the visibility right here. So this would work in the following way. We just define as the parity, as the probability of finding either both in the D state, both in the S state. This would be parity plus one. And this is what we call a parity minus one. This would be the odd numbers. And then we just add this up and see this change. And here, the large contributions would be, of course, this state, and the other ones would be the odd parity. Now, there's a slightly different way of creating belt states. That's a complicated way of creating belt states. A belt state, if you look at it, these are two ions sitting there, could be created by just now working with all these pi over 2 pi pulses and the manipulation pulses in the following simple way. Suppose you start out with 2 pi ions in the ground state like that. So both are in the S state, and this is now in the vibration state 0. This is red, this is the one where we point the laser to. So we make a transition on this particle. And we apply first the pi over 2 pulse on the blue sideband. From what you've learned now, you know the pi over 2 pulse changes from S 0, it affects only the first ion, it changes to D and 1, and we just make a pi over 2 pulse, so we have the coherent superposition of this. This S state here, the blue S, is not affected at all. Okay? From what I've said before, this is easily to be concluded. Now we move the beam by addressing individually the second one to the second ion. Now we make a pi pulse on the carrier, so we're affecting only the D state. But on the carrier, we just should not be D, but let me just see how this works. It's a carrier pulse, so it just affects the S to D, and should be and should affect, of course, and it should affect the S, and that should go to the D. It does. Sorry for that. So the S goes to D, and the S goes to D. That's a pulse on the carrier on the second ion. The vibration is not affected at all. Then we have a pi pulse on the blue sideband. So the blue sideband on the same ion, the second one, changes only the D to the S, and it changes the 1 to the 0. So we have SD0 plus DS0. So you see, this is both the vibration and the ground state, so it factors out. So we can just leave this away. Procedure clear? Well, you just make the right procedures, because here you can see this pi pulse right here in the blue sideband can't go here, so this is why it doesn't affect anything at this point. That's the trick. Was that too fast? Okay, so let's go. Now we can do that. Take our ion first, and this is now the circuit diagram, as we write it down usually. The second ion, this is a timeline. We apply blue sideband, pi over 2 pulse, from state 0, then the carrier pulse here. And you see now the mathematics simply shows you where we are when we include the phase, the local phases. This is the carrier pulse, that just doesn't do anything. And then there's blue sideband pulse here, and then we wait a certain time, then we make a carrier pulse on the pi and the 0 right here, and then we make the analyzing pulses, which you can make the parity measurement, that's what it does here. And then we create, in this case, the SS plus DD with a local phase that we can really adjust by the phases right here. So this is a procedure with which we can also create belt states. And the belt states, of course, can be measured simply by the parities. But really measuring that we have coherences requires a thing that's called tomography. And if I have another few minutes, I can just conclude with that one, then you get all the details, and maybe then in the question and answer session we can talk a little bit about the concatenated pulses. So the belt states are best analyzed now by a full state analysis. How do we do a full quantum state analysis? Now usually, when we make a full description of the quantum state, we usually write down density matrices. Wave function is fine. But when we measure populations, we already work with density matrices. Let's do this. The density matrix can be represented here in such a way that we have a sum of orthogonal observables AI. These are usually the populations that we find in the system, where we just define that the trace of these AI should be to a delta function. These rows are then completely determined by the expectation values that we get there. So we can write down it as a trace of the row times AI, and we can just look for these lambda j's here. And these lambda j's can be again measured from the expectation values that we have in the system. So let's just write this down for a two-level system, for a two-qubit system, for two-level systems. So we usually and conveniently choose our operators A, which are written down in a very general notation, from, of course, the Pauli matrices. And we want to measure the expectation values to those. Of course, the Pauli matrix identity, they can X, Y, and C. So the idea is now to get to a representation of the density matrix where we measure the expectation value of in the basis of all the Pauli matrices. So what is the basis that we write down this direct product of the Pauli matrices and this decompose then the density matrix in terms of the Pauli matrices? Any other basis will do too, but that's the general and generic basis for our two-level systems. And then we can reconstruct this from the data that we have, and I'll show you that in a minute. But as I said repeatedly so far, this is not necessarily semi-positive, it's semi-definite. And I'll show you how this comes about. But then there's a way of fitting the most likely density matrix that describes the quantum state that I've got with semi-positive, semi-definite density matrices to the one that I've observed. And there's the original paper by Radio, and in the meantime there's a few other procedures available. What they do is they choose the row in such a way, and I just minimize this function, maximum likelihood function, in such a way that I get the right 15 parameters that describe the system. Sounds very theoretical, and I would like you to ask to go through these things if you don't get them right now, because it took us also about a year to understand these things in detail. How does that work? Suppose for a minute you have the same two ions that we had before, and we want to analyze the build state that we created. And suppose we want to measure now the qubit operation sigma I and j, and we want to evaluate the expectation values. What we usually do is we just cool the ground state, prepare the quantum state, in this case the build state for example, and we apply the tomography pulses and do state detection. Again, you see this is the level scheme, nothing new. First of all, we initialize things in SS0 by Doppler and sideband coolings, and then we do the quantum state manipulation that is on the qubit transition now minus half, one half to minus one half, as I said before, because that's less dependent on the magnetic field. This is another detail. Then we just do fluorescence detection right here, and then we just conclude whether the system was in any of these states. So we just measure the probabilities of finding things in SS, SD, DS, or P, DD. This is all what we get from the measurement. When you do that, you do the following. So first of all, you prepare the build state, and then you measure. What do you measure? You always measure whether we have a population in the excited state. By concluding this from the quantum jump measurement, there's something in the ground state, then we don't see it, then we see everything. If something is excited, so we don't see anything. So essentially what we measure is in the basis of sigma C for each ion. This would be for the first ion, for the second ion. But of course we have a camera picture that we immediately see the correlation. The first ion is in D state and the other one is in S state, for example, or both ions in D S state. So these are the expectation values of the parameters that we actually can see. The measurement is always in the sigma C basis. That's understood. We do not have direct access to the X and to the sigma Y basis. The question is, how can we do that? Now, if we just calculate first in the sigma C basis the populations, and then this is the PDD plus PDS minus PSD minus PSS, we go through the numbers calculating just the expectation value for the sigma C's. Put the operators there and calculate what the probabilities are to do this, you'll find this. The same thing applies here with sigma C too, and this is for the correlated value. You see there's plus and minuses of the probabilities of finding these things. And of course, within the experimental error bounds, these things can become negative, although this is not supposed to be. So we have to make sure that this is what we do, and this is to be compared later on with the maximum likelihood preparation. But how do we get access now to sigma x? Now, sigma x can be done in such a way. You know, sigma x is the expectation value along this axis. So we just rotate, for example, prior to the measurement, the Bloch sphere by applying a pi over 2 pulse in such a way to the system that when we measure now, effectively, we measure the expectation value of sigma x. And if you change the phase of the laser, so we just do that in the same way for sigma y. because that's the phase in the rotating sphere. Is that understood too? So in other words, what we, the measurement procedure is to do this over and over again. We prepare a bed set, do no rotation, we measure that 200 repetitions. We prepare it again and measure that on sigma I number 1, do a sigma x rotation there. We don't do anything on sigma on I number 2, measure the sigma c, which of course essentially is x sigma c. Then measure that again with 9 different settings and do this for all of these things. And again, you can go through the... Yeah, in fact, what we are doing, we are just viewing the image from various sides. And so if you just have one projection, you would not conclude that this is a pile of rubbish. So you have to take very many projections in order to get the true nature of what you really have there. That's what I want to tell you that. So just to do it, what we do is you have 9 settings. If you go through this, first of all, you don't do anything. Then you measure sigma C1, 2, and both. Then you just make that rotation. Don't do anything here. You measure sigma X. You don't have to measure that one because you already measured this, but you want to make the correlation right here. So that's redundant information as well. The blue ones are the ones that we really need. Once we have all of these values, then we can reconstruct the density matrix from these expectation values according to what I said before, because it's really measured now on the Pauli basis. And that's what we've done. And when you just calculate now the block, from all of these block matrices of the expectation values of the sigmas that we have, then we get these expectation values for the let's say the signatures for the Bell states. This would be the Bell state GE plus EG, so it's all positive, there should be zero imaginary part. This would be the one GG plus EE. You readily can see this, this is GG plus EE, these are the populations, but these are the coherences. And the coherences are all there. So you really see immediately the coherences pop up. That should be ideally zero. And you see this is GE minus EG, so minus value is really contained in there, and this is the same here. So you readily can see from the fingerprint that we measure in tomography what the state really is. So this is a very valuable technology. The difficulty is only that you have to make so many rotations. Now you can see this was done for a Bell state with 2 ions. If you want to do this for any other state of, say, many more ions, you have to do so many rotations, this explodes in your face. And that's why we have done this only for up to numbers of 8 ions and not more than that. And this quantum state tomography is actually then a joint measurement of all these spin components that really makes the system doable. And this is what I wanted to cover in my first lecture. So I've covered this only in 2 lectures now. I know we are at the end of this time. If we really want to know more about the concatenated pulses, I could show you 3 more slides on that. I did not take the time now to go through all the advanced procedures that we have to show you all these things. But I think these 2 lectures were supposed to show you how we manipulate things on the individual 2-level systems and to show you the basics, which are underlying Rabi spectroscopy, Ramsey spectroscopy, the basic operations in single 2-level quantum optics that we have here, which are really ingrained in all of this, and we are naturally talking always about these things. Okay, if you were patient enough and you were still hungry, not hungry enough for lunch, but hungry for science, I can show you more about composite pulses. Is that okay? So let's see where I have that. This is it. This was for another lecture, and I was trying to show you the qubit rotations in the computational subspace. Remember, this is the subspace that we have all the time, but of course, you want to make sure that we stay in this subspace, because suppose for a minute with a zero-solar idea, we just are here, and then make a transition on the blue sideband, then we would leave that computational subspace, and the rule that we have in the zero-solar idea that eventually we can't make a transition here would no longer be true, because we then would just go back here or go back there. That would mix things completely. So really we want to keep that computational subspace, and that really is the difficulty why we have to go to other pulses. Remember, these are the rotations that we do in our computational subspace with all these blue and red sidebands and the carrier. Now, the idea is the following. Suppose for a minute we want to make a pi rotation here, because the pi rotation would be a perfect swap operation of this kind. This would be a swap and a composite swap operation. Then, this, if there were some residual population right here, it would swap things from here to there, and if I just go back, it would not come back completely, because this is a pi by times square root of 2, because faster, because of the Bose factor that's in there. This can be changed by a so-called composite swap operation. This is something I'll show you when you just subdivide this pulse in three different pulses. What does that do? Now the composite swap does in the first place, if you just have an ordinary swap, just make a pi pulse. The pi pulse is simply something from the Bloch sphere, you go from up to down, period. That's it. But if you were on this two-level system right here, something is there, and you just make then something which goes up there, from up there, from up down here, it would never do this, because this is only pi for these two levels, but not for these two levels, and they're all simultaneously present. So if you have some residual population here, it would not work. But if you make the following, for example, you make a pi pulse, which is not exactly pi, but you just end at this point, that would be pi over square root of 2 with the phase of pi, that would be the rotation angle. And then you just change the rotation angle, this would be the axis of the rotation, and make another 2 pi times square root of divided by square root of 2 pulse right here, or pi times square root of 2 pulse. And the axis changes to square root of 2 times pi, and you see the square root of 2 is there coming in here because of the Bose factors. Then you would end up here, and then you would just end up on this one. From here you would go in the third part all the way down. These three pulses in a row, although this is exceedingly complicated, they do nothing but a pi pulse. Now you're saying, why should I undergo such a complicated pulse structure to make a pi pulse which I could have done in an easy way? Now let me just show you why. If you just consider that, on this transition S0 and D1, then of course it does a pi pulse. But if you consider that with all the Bose factors that are involved on the transition, S1 to D2, then you see you have to multiply all the transitions that you have here, the strength of these, by a factor of square root of 2. If you do that, then you see the first pulse is already a pi pulse of this one, it ends up here. The second pulse is a factor of 2 pi pulse, goes all the way around here. The third one is also a 2 pi pulse, so it makes another pi pulse here. So it is essentially a 4 pi pulse. And a 4 pi pulse on the second two-level system, of course, doesn't do anything, because a 4 pi pulse, that's just a phase plus 1. So in case you had something that has left the computational subspace there, it does the minus sign on the one that you really wanted to have, but it keeps the plus sign on the one that's affected here. That never really leaves the computational subspace. So breaking a single pulse in three different pulses is called a composite pulse sequence. That's how we really make these things. This was now explained for replacing a pi pulse with just three different pulses of different lengths and different angles. This is known from NMR, and it's insensitive against higher order excitation. Of course, it would not work for the next higher step, because there are other Bose factors involved, but of course we are relying on the fact that we are in the Lamb-Digger regime, so you should not have these difficulties. And now you can do the same trick for the phase gate, that is to apply a minus sign if the system has a vibration of 1. So what you want to do is, once the system is in level 1, you want to apply a 2 pi pulse, but when it's somewhere higher excited, you want to make sure that there's always a 4 pi rotation involved. And this is what we do. So the phase gate, which is really that sequence of 4 pulses that I've shown you before, the Sirak-Sola idea, that's broken down, that simply would be a 2 pi pulse initially, but that's broken down in 4 pulses of this length, pi divided by square root of 2, pi and another pi divided by square root of 2. And if you do this for the other system where there is a square root of 2 involved, you have to multiply these pulses by square root of 2. Would be square root of 2 first, then it would be pi, square root of 2 pi, and then again, so you see immediately what happens. The first step, the first pulse, puts the spin down here. The second pulse, with a changed rotation axis, puts it down there. The other one goes down here, and the fourth pulse goes all the way up. So it's a 2 pi rotation on S0 and D1, which adds the minus sign if you apply that transition. But if you multiply these things on the S1 to the D2 state, which would otherwise perturb the system, then you see, again, it adds up to a 4 pi rotation, because when you just apply these things, The first one goes all the way down. The third one goes, the second one goes all the way around here. The third one goes around, and the fourth one goes all the way from here. So it's 4π. That is a concatenated pulse technique that I learned from NMR a long time ago together with Ike from Zhuang. And this is routinely used in all the systems in order to protect the computational subspace. That makes things more complicated than seemingly done. But instead of applying a single pulse, you're applying simply 3 or 4 pulses depending on what you want to do. So this is a concatenated pulse technique, and you can actually see that these things work. And these are the traces that you've seen before. When you just look at these things, you just apply the pulse sequence and they do precisely what you expected, and then you can just make all the gate operations, and this is what I call this fancy dance on the block sphere. So we control the motion on the block sphere at will with these concatenated pulses, and we can make all these gate operations as indicated before. And with this, you can then make all the stuff. That brings me to an end. If you have further questions, don't hesitate to ask me. I apologize, I didn't talk about the much more advanced systems that we did over the last, say, 4 or 5 years. But if you really want to know more, read the papers, and I would refer you to Yasser Omar, who has all the papers now and has also the tasks that are assigned to you. Just go through the numbers. I think it's probably fun for you to learn how these things work. If you have questions, don't hesitate to ask me via Yasser. He knows how to reach me, and I thank you for your attention.
Thank you very much.
Good question. The point simply is the collective motion, of course, that I've shown you there with the initial picture, that was a motion where the motion was excited by hundreds of thousands of n. When we just have an excitation by n equals 1, and then it just changes the system by maybe a nanometer or 2, so it doesn't do anything. So, with the resolution that we have, which is about 1 micron, that doesn't do anything. But of course, it would do something if we had to go to a huge excitation, which we can't, because then the Lamp-Digger approximation breaks down.
Any other questions, please?
I'm just thinking out of curiosity. Here you have shown how to find these ions in line. Is it much more complicated to create kind of a two-dimensional array of ions confined this way?
It is much more complicated, but yes, we are doing this.
You are doing
this? We are doing this, and there's drug development going on, also in 3-4 groups in the world, to really go to 2 dimensions. Because that is really the future, to scale the system up to a larger scale. Because in a string, in a long string, you can see this holds only so long. Because if you have these strings, then remember the Lamp-Digger parameter has also a mass term there because of the ground state. With the harmonic oscillator potential. And when you add ions, and then of course this adds to the mass of the entire string. So if you just shake one ion, you immediately see the heavier the ion chain gets, the longer it takes for the ions to react, because the Lamp-Digger factor becomes smaller. So this renders the system slow in the end, and scalability is really hampered. And we can possibly live with, say, a few 10 ions. We've done this with about 30, 40 ions. I think we can deal with ions up to maybe 100, but then it's going to be really difficult to scale the system up. So the suggestion is for a long time to go to two-dimensional traps, and this can be done by so-called surface traps. You have to shape the potential strike, so we would go through another round of lectures and I can show you how this works, but it is difficult. You can imagine that. Try to operate with magnets. Just take 3-4 magnets, and which are all repelling each other, and now try to squish them together because you really want them to interact. What happens is, if you don't confine them in this plane, they just explode in your face. And that's exactly what happens with the ions, because the ions repel each other when you don't try to confine them laterally to make in a grid. They have to make sure that this confinement here really is stiff enough But usually that's hard to do because you usually don't have 3D structures, but only 2D, two-dimensional structures to do that. And so there are ways around that, but it is still open to research, and it's not yet completely solved. But that's the idea.
And what about scalability of gate operations? You mentioned you could do this 200 gate operations per second. At 20.
Not per second. You can do you can do it. The 200 gate operations we do already in about a few milliseconds already. If you could wait a second, we could do many more. But it's the coherence time that counts. So it's this is what we can do at this time with our gate operations up to 200 maybe, and then we lose the coherence of the system. So you would have to prepare the system in a much better way. So you would have to go to you would have to go to a coherence time that's much longer, long lived, to really protect the system in such a way, or active error correction. But this is on the way. So far, scalability requires that you get to better fidelities of the individual gate operations. That's one way of doing it. And that you really control the system better for longer times. The other way that we are currently trying to do is not to go to really long times. Nobody wants to wait a day to complete the computation, but to make the gate operation shorter and shorter and shorter. So there's ideas around, also from quantum optimal control. We call this bang-bang control because we are using now picosecond pulses to do this. And we are trying to, the proposals are out there for about 10 years, but we are really trying to implement this now to make a gate operation instead of, say, 10, 20 microseconds in about 10 nanoseconds. That would give us a lot more leeway.
Any more questions? So let me thank Heinrich again for being here.